So I want to just touch on a little bit what you should be doing 6 weeks before your child custody trial. Now, again, deadlines are going to differ from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And so not only do you have to look at your state rules or your local rules or your country rules or your county rules, you should also be looking at your judge's minutes, your minute entries where the judge is setting trial. Because at least in Arizona, the judges can change our deadline set by rules in their minute entries, and often they do. So look at all of those things so you know what should be happening 6 weeks before your trial. So the things that I'm going to be talking about are really just guidelines, but you always have to look at your rules. When trial is set, it's important for you to look at that minute entry where the judge sets trial and to calendar all of the deadlines that you have in front of you. And this is one of the things that I cover in the 21-day child custody challenge. Calendaring is really, it's one of the most important functions of my law office because a client's case can be destroyed if a deadline is missed. So we have not just one and not just two, but we have three people checking to make sure that all deadlines are docketed. And if you're handling your case, then you should be checking it a few times and maybe even have somebody taking a second look at the deadlines you've docketed. But generally speaking, when we're about 6 weeks before trial, I am looking at my client's file to see everything that they've disclosed or that they've given to me to make sure that we've provided those things to the other side. This is called disclosure, and there are deadlines for disclosure prior to trial. A lot of times people get confused because the judge's minute entries often say 7 days prior to trial, you have to exchange exhibits with the other party. So sometimes people think that this is when they're giving the other party exhibits for the first time. No, there's a difference between that, exchanging your exhibits, and disclosing the exhibits prior to trial. So when you're ex so let me give you an example to better illustrate this. I've had cases where there's like 100 exhibits listed for trial, but we may have disclosed 200 potential exhibits prior to trial. Well, at least where I practice, judges, they don't really expect each side to figure out what the other side might use as an exhibit. They expect each side to tell the other side exactly what is going to be used as an exhibit from the information that they have disclosed during the pendency of the case. So there is a difference between disclosing the information you could use at trial for the first time. There's a difference between that and exchanging the exhibits that you're actually going to use at trial, the exhibits that you've actually narrowed down from your initial disclosure. In the course of the case, you have to disclose the stuff that you might use at trial to the other side. And normally, discovery should be continuous and ongoing. I'm not saying it has to be 6 weeks. You have to look at your local rules. I'm not saying it has to be 6 weeks. Look at your rules, look at your minute entries. Generally speaking, this is what I'm doing 6 weeks before trial. So I'm making sure that anything and everything my client's given to me as a potential exhibit at trial has been given to the other side. So the point of disclosure and exchanging disclosure is to make sure that the other side has notice of exhibits that you might use and notice of the claims that you might raise. That's the purpose of disclosure because there's not trial by ambush. When you go to court, one side should not be giving the other side exhibits on the day of trial or the week before trial. That stuff should have been disclosed and exchanged way before trial, okay? Really as it came in. But look at your rules, look at your rules, look at your rules to see what the discovery deadlines are and the disclosure deadlines are. Look at your rules, look at your judge's minute entries. Okay, so I get a piece of paper from my client that's, and say it's some text messages, and my client says, I might want to use this as evidence at trial. So then my job is to give it to the other attorney or the other party and say, we might use this at trial. That's called disclosure. And there's different ways that you can disclose things. So you disclose information you might use at trial. But as you get closer to trial, you are looking at your evidence and your witnesses and you're figuring out what your claims are and you are really whittling down what you're actually going to use. So, in some of my cases, we have 30 disclosure statements because there's so much evidence and there might be hundreds and hundreds of potential exhibits, but that doesn't mean we're going to use every single one of those exhibits at trial. We're going to use the exhibits that are most relevant to whatever it is that we're trying to show the judge. So out of 2,000 exhibits, as an example, I might only be using 20 at trial, 20 of what I disclosed. So as you get closer to trial, you're whittling down what you're going to use, because let's face it, the time that you have for trial is really limited, at least in Arizona. In Arizona, we don't get days and days and days for trials. Most of the time, the most that I get is 3 hours for trial. So I have to plan my evidence very wisely, and I have to use the best evidence that I have. So when you get to trial, there's going to be a clerk in the courtroom. And usually the clerk is the one who marks your exhibits with certain tags. And I go into this more deeply in some of my programs, so I'm not going to go into it super deep. But the clerk marks the evidence with these evidence tags. And, you know, they're numbered one, you know, plaintiff's exhibit or petitioner's exhibit number one, number two, number three, number four. So you have to understand, you know, sometimes I go to trial and I have 100 exhibits marked. Well, in order for the clerk to have those exhibits ready for trial, the clerk has to receive the exhibits you're actually going to use prior to the day of your trial. So what the judge does is the judge sets deadlines by when you have to give your exhibits that you are going to try to use to the clerk. So in Arizona, most of the time it happens to be a week before trial, 5 business days or 7 calendar days. Rolling it back to what you should be doing. One, you should always be looking at your local rules, but generally speaking, 6 weeks before trial, you know, and depending on your state, you may have already passed the deadline for disclosure. But having said that, sometimes my client will give me something 3 weeks before trial and they say, I'm going to try to use it. Well, I still disclose it. Just because it's late doesn't mean I don't disclose it. I disclose it. I disclose it even if it's 3 days before trial. I know it's really late. I know that it may not be able to be used, but you should always, always disclose. If you've disclosed something late, you may have difficulty getting it into evidence because it was late disclosed, but still disclose it. It's an uncomfortable situation when my client gives me something like 2 days before trial and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I got to give it to the other attorney and try to get it into evidence. But if it's something that really is helpful to the case, then I will try. And sometimes we actually get lucky. So it doesn't hurt to try. You have to be courageous even when you think you might get chewed out by the judge, and do your best. Okay, so 6 weeks before trial, you are checking your calendar, checking the minute entry, checking the rules, and checking your deadlines to make sure you have everything calendared, making sure everything is disclosed, and then you're looking ahead at the deadlines that are coming up prior to trial. So some of the common deadlines that you're going to have prior to trial could be, for one, giving your exhibits to the clerk for marking prior to the trial. So the Tenacious Warrior said in her state, they do it differently than they do it in Arizona. And that may be the case for a lot of you. I can just speak for Arizona. But in Tenacious Warrior's case, the judge, they mark it at the time of trial. And that may be the case in your situation. If it is, it is. It's one less thing you have to worry about. One thing you should look at that's very important, one thing you have to do that you have to be aware of, is the pretrial statement. So the pretrial statement is where you give the judge, the preview of the things that you agree on and the preview of the things that you don't agree on. So when there is a pretrial statement, you give a preview of the information you agree on, a preview of the information you don't agree on, and your proposals for resolving the case. And I was just at a continuing legal education conference for attorneys. So in order to keep my license, I have to do 15 hours of continuing legal education. So I was at a family law conference. And there was a panel of judges speaking at the conference, and they talked about pretrial statements and how important those statements are in framing people's positions for trials. And some of these judges said that they actually ask for Word documents. You know, they ask the attorneys or the parties to send them a Word electronic document of the pretrial statement so they can cut and paste. They often use portions of a party's pretrial statement to cut and paste into their decision. So you should be spending a lot of time on your pretrial statements if your state requires one. This is a very important document. It's an opportunity to get your position in front of the judge and also the legal reasons why the judge should be giving you the relief that you want. So when I was in law school, when we were writing motions, we were taught to set forth our arguments and the law, and you always have to be upfront with the court, with the law, even if the law is not in your favor. That's called having a duty of candor to the court. So we put our facts in the law that supports our facts. But if there is law that doesn't support the facts or there's a counter argument, then you should be including that as well. Pre-trial statement. I'm delving into pre-trial statements in the 6 weeks before trial. So you're thinking about evidence, you are thinking about the witnesses that you're going to potentially call, and you're starting to narrow down their testimony. You're starting to write questions for them. You're starting to outline your potential areas of testimony. So my pre-trial statement is really great also because it is the outline that I use to develop the testimony for my clients at trial. So in Arizona, when I am doing a custody case, one of the things that is very important is to touch on those best interest factors. In Arizona, they're called the 403 factors, Section 25-403 of the Arizona Revised Statute. So I list out every single one of those best interest factors, and I go into how those apply in my client's case. So the judge can have a preview of what's going to be presented. When I do the pretrial statement, then that's what I use as the outline for my client's testimony. And I just hit each of those best interest factors. What else should you be doing 6 weeks before trial? Getting witnesses ready, starting to write out questions. If you are calling witnesses, then I would, prepare with your witnesses, get them a copy of the questions. If you're going to show them any exhibits and try to admit exhibits while they're on the stand, then make sure they're familiar with those exhibits because there's nothing worse than showing a witness an exhibit thinking they're going to know what it is and then they have no clue what it is and it makes you look silly. And even if the witness, sometimes they've written the email or they're the ones who created the exhibit, but when you're in the courtroom, it kind of feels like you're in another world sometimes. And sometimes witnesses kind of lose it a little bit, they freak out, they get nervous, they forget. So that's why it's important to prepare with them ahead of time, but not over prepare. So it doesn't, you don't want it to look too rehearsed. What else am I doing 6 weeks before trial? I'm just kind of getting my head in the right space. So that's actually something that we should talk about is mindset. Mindset's very important. Like with Olympic athletes, it's really important for them to be in the best physical shape that they can be in. Olympic athletes are in awesome physical shape, but I've heard that they work on just as much as their physical condition, they work on their mental condition just as much as the physical or more, because a lot of times, what separates them from the rest of the pack is the mental edge. So you have got to get your head in the right place, and this is scary. There's a lot at stake. I know you are afraid, that you might be losing your children, but you have to go in there and just know that you're going to do the best you can and that you're going to act in spite of your fear. That is the definition of courage. You have to tell yourself that you're going to speak with confidence and that you're going to be studied in the law so you can be competent when you get in front of the judge. Those are really important things, but you have to work on your head. And so whatever it is that helps you feel grounded and centered, you have to do it. It's so important because this is a high stress situation and you have to be cool as a cucumber. And if you don't have some way of getting yourself centered, then, a judge asks a tough question, you may not have the answer come to you. So, and speaking of the best interest factors, if you haven't already, go to commandthecourtroom.com, download the checklist because those factors are very important. So those are all the things that I am doing 6 weeks before trial. So you should be doing something similar. And I'm not telling you 6 weeks before trial is when your deadline to disclose is. You have to look at your rules, okay? I can't stress that enough. Look at your rules because your rules may say your deadline to disclose is 8 weeks before trial, and you have to listen to that. Don't listen to me. There are a lot of variances between states, but there are a lot of differences.